Well, good evening, everyone. My name is Varun Soni. I'm the Dean of Religious Life at the University of Southern California. Thank you. On behalf of USC Spectrum, the Art of Living Foundation, the International Association of Human Values, the USC Yoga and Service Club, and the USC Office of Religious Life, I'm honored to welcome you all to our very special event entitled Close Encounters of the Screen Kind, Investigating the Role of Human Values in Hollywood, an evening with Sri Ravi Shankar. Before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge the very hard work of many individuals who made this event possible. In particular, I'm very grateful to Gaurav Srivastava, Dane Martins, John Osborne, Krishan Unakrishan, Austin Myers, and Rachna Ruthi. So please join me now in thanking them for all their hard work. On a more serious note, as many of you know, this has been a devastating week for all of us at USC as we mourn the tragic deaths of our beloved students, Ing Wu and Ming Chu. I was just at the university memorial service with several thousand people, and I spent the last week with their friends and their families. This evening at the service, we asked ourselves, can there be a greater sorrow than this, a lament greater than that for young lives lost? As a community, we are struck silent, and yet we feel a need to speak, to remember, to share, to honor, and to grasp at comfort and comprehension. In times of tragedy, our focus on human values and creative narrative becomes even more important. Indeed, since ancient times, storytelling has served as a powerful way for us to find meaning and purpose in life, to wrestle with the ultimate existential issues that we face, and to convene and create communities of solidarity and support. This evening, we'll explore ways in which we cultivate and inspire awareness and promote human values through film, television, and new media. Through their respective lenses of expertise, His Holiness Sri Sri Ravi Shankar and our distinguished guests will examine this crucial question. Their presentations will be followed by a moderated panel discussion, exploring how the stories we see on screen changes the stories we live as human beings. And on a personal note, when I met with His Holiness earlier, I thanked him for being here during this very difficult time of bereavement for all of us. Guruji's presence here is truly a blessing and a great source of solace and comfort for our university community. We're so fortunate to have him on our campus, and we're so grateful that the Art of Living Foundation is right here in our neighborhood. And now I'm honored to introduce my friend, John Osborne, a senior faculty member and founding member of the Art of Living Foundation. He has taught meditation and personal development in over 35 countries since 1975, and he's currently leading a project involving meditation for returning U.S. military personnel afflicted with post-traumatic stress syndrome. Please join me in welcoming John Osborne.
Thank you, Dean Soni, and welcome on behalf of not only University of Southern California, but also the Art of Living Foundation and the International Association for Human Values. I know it's not me you've come here to see tonight, so I'll be blessedly brief. I just was thinking as I was upstairs preparing for this event that it seems like yesterday that I was in another college room just exactly like this, except it was 1988, it was the University of California at Santa Barbara, and I was hearing Sri Sri for the first time. Didn't quite know what to make of him, didn't quite know why I was doing there. Maybe some of you are having these same experiences right now. But what I can tell you is that since that time that I've met him, my life is barely recognizable. I had a wonderful, nice, small life when I met Sri Sri Ravi Shankar in 1988, but I couldn't have imagined or foreseen the adventures that I'd have and the ability to make a difference in the lives of people all over the world that he would provide. There is simply no one else in the world that I know who's doing as much for as many people around the world as His Holiness Sri Sri Ravi Shankar. The other thing that came to me today, with this event coming on the wings of a tragedy here at University of Southern California, somehow a copy of the New York Times came up in my hand that was published right after 9/11. And there's a quote from the New York Times at that time from Sri Ravi Shankar. He was talking about the long-term remedy for terrorism, but it could just as easily be the long-term remedy for senseless violence. He said, "Today, terrorism is a global social concern. As a long-term remedy, we need to educate the entire population of the world to, number one, value life itself more than religion, race, or culture. Number two, live the human values of friendliness, compassion, cooperation, and a sense of belongingness to all people. Number three, honor diversity and appreciate all religious and cultural traditions, for the world will not be safe if even a small pocket of people are left separated. Number four, adopt practical methods to release stress and tension in life. Stress is the root cause of all conflict and violence. Number five, have confidence that we can achieve change through peaceful and nonviolent means. In the short run, force may be necessary to suppress terrorism. In the long run, spirituality alone can root out destructive tendencies in us all." I'd like to conclude with a short video on the life and work of Sri Sri Ravi Shankar. He'll be with us in just a few minutes. Again, on behalf of the Foundation and USC, thank you very much for being with us tonight.
Cannot stand tension or stress for too long. Somewhere one has to give up. You can't hold your fist too long like that. Somewhere you have to relax. And when you relax, you see the whole sky is on your hand. That tendency is began in the world.
In case I don't have a chance to announce it later, for those of you who enjoy this evening, there's a meditation, a series of talks on meditation that Sri Sri will be giving at our center, which is at the corner of Adams and Hoover, just four or five blocks away from here. And uniquely, this is the first time we've done it, Sri Sri will describe meditation, lead people in meditation, and this weekend at the same time, we'll have a meditation course so that you can actually hear about meditation and then learn the process of meditation during the weekend. Please join me in welcoming His Holiness Sri Sri Ravi Shankar.
This mic will do. This is fine. you know, I don't know how to give a talk, but I can only informally interact. That has been my style all through. Creating a sense of belongingness amongst people of the world, which we all had as a children. As babies, we all had that innocent corner deep within us, right? There was no walls, there was no pretensions. We related to everyone naturally, spontaneously. My dream is to bring back that little world. I think you have it in Disneyland, yeah. That little world back in society. A crime-free, stress-free, violence-free society. Can you all dream like that? Huh? Can you join me in making a world which is free from inhibitions, prejudice? A world where differences are celebrated rather than making it a point of contention and conflict. Somewhere, mankind has forgotten to celebrate differences. And that's where violence has sprouted and grown wild like wildfire today. From the angle of science or arts, if you see this one consciousness which is everywhere in the world, with all beings, that's so powerful, that's so beautiful, and that's so true, that need to be brought up into one's awareness. That's what we are all, you know. We are all made up of this substance. Our consciousness is made up of substance called love, compassion, beauty. And it just gets covered by stress and distress and mistrust, lack of trust. All these things have covered it. We can't lose this at all because it's our very nature. So film is a very important medium of communication. You know, you can hear a lot, but when you see, it just makes a deep impression. Through film, if science can trigger the quest, inquisitiveness in a person, through film, the art can bring beauty, ecstasy, and joy. Through film, spiritual awakening can also happen. To me, spiritual awakening is where you become aware of your true nature, your connection with the whole universe and with all the people in the planet. You know, we are made up of both matter and spirit. Spirit is all that beauty, love, truth, integrity, honesty, all these values that we possess, we are born with. Paying little attention to that, you know, giving a broader vision to life, seeing life from a broader perspective. In the context of the universe, makes a very big difference.
Don't you think so? When I was in my school, I had seen a movie. It's a silent movie. You know, by the way, I have also participated in a movie. It's a silent movie. It had only two sentences, the entire movie. The sentence is, just let it be, don't worry. These are the only two sentences which I have spoken. In that I have said, just let it be, don't worry. But the movie is about a boy who got into drug addiction and then how he comes out of it. It's a true story. It's a real happening which was captured. As I said, when I was a boy, I had seen a movie which had only music and only actions, silent throughout. No conversation, no words. You know, it, though there are very few, it's not a commercially viable movie, I tell you. Not many people would go for it. But those who have taste, who are sensitive, would appreciate it like anything. Because there are two categories in the world. There are those that sells, you know, James Bond sort of thing, that people, the mass marketing. But then there are the refined level of society which appreciates the fineness of arts. So there are many ways to convey the inexpressible. And life itself is an effort to convey that which cannot be conveyed. Life is an effort to contain the infinity in a short span of time and express it, you know. Expression of infinity, expression of divinity in the finite manner, in the most refined manner, is human life. And that's a challenge. It's a challenge. I know we have experts in this field who are going to talk to us, and I'm also eager to listen to them all. So in the end, I will take some questions if you have any. I'll take the questions. I don't know whether I'm going to give the answer. If I have, I'll give you. Yeah? One divinity, one humanity, celebrating the diversity, this is our sacred duty. It's our sacred duty. If we can all get in touch with that inner space, that's a miracle in itself. And nothing whatsoever can take the smile away from us then. And each one of you is so precious, I tell you. I hear these days in college campuses, so many youths are committing suicide or there is violence in the campus. My heart goes for them. I say, oh, they have something so precious inside them, but they're not able to tap it, get recourse to it. This is so sad. I heard today there was a memorial service here. I wish that such things, all of us wish such things to not happen again or repeat. For this, we need to proactively do something, that is to bring this point to our youths that life is more precious. Please don't take it away. Life is so precious, and you are needed in this planet. You are needed in this earth, and we are all with you. This message should go clear, loud and clear to youths, and tell them they are not alone. We are all with them. Shall we do this? Shall we all pass this message to youths? Yes. Yes. Are you all here?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
So the format of today's event will be that we have three panelists. They'll each present for several minutes on the work that they do and the connection to human values, and then we'll have a moderated panel discussion. It's my honor to introduce our first panelist, Jeremy Kagan, internationally recognized director, writer, producer, and USC professor. Jeremy Kagan has made a number of award-winning feature films, including The Chosen and The Journey of Natty Gann. He has also made 20 television movies and earned an Emmy for directing a TV series. He produced and directed the 10-part award-winning series Freedom Files about threats to our civil liberties, and he founded the Change-Making Media Lab, which makes films for NGOs like the Doe Fund with a focus on the homeless. He has served as the artistic director of Robert Redford's Sundance Lab and is the chair of special projects for the Directors Guild of America, which serves 14,000 members. He is also the author of the book Directors Close Up, with the third edition coming out in the fall. Please join me in welcoming Professor Jeremy Kagan.
Woo was some of my students, which I'm very, in fact, I'm only standing here because of my students. Oh, that's really true. Actually, I'm also standing here because of the Gita. I want you to know that too. Because I was been listening on my cell phone as I drive. I'm careful about this. I've been listening to the Gita and also Ram Dass' commentary on the Gita. And so all of a sudden, out of nowhere, Krishna calls me. Or maybe out of everywhere, Krishna calls me. And you know, those of you who know the story, he knows the story. He knew it by memory when he was a young boy. That's how, so who am I talking to? But at least from these many English translations, there's Arjuna who has a battle in front of him. Now, but it's a real battle. They're going to kill people. And I'm thinking, well, how do I feel about that? And Krishna is saying, you know, you have your duty. You have actions to fulfill, battles to fight. And I'm a pacifist. I'm standing here because I was a pacifist. I said when Vietnam was happening, I said I didn't want to serve because I didn't want to kill anybody. Later, I met my wife, and I said I was a CO, and she said, you were a commanding officer. I guess that doesn't go over anymore because COs are conscientious objectors. Conscientious objectors. It's a great phrase when you think about it. To be conscious of who we really are and what we really want. And we just heard a beautiful expression of it by this being who's here, as well as the words he just gave us. And to be an objector. And there are two parts of that. There's the, in a way, objective. Can we look at our own lives and all the stress that we have, like all the stress I have even right now, a little less so because of what he said. He did say be spontaneous. And look at ourselves outside ourselves. So we are not the victims that we often create in our own minds. That's an objective look. And then to actually stand and object to that which is on this level, behavior that's wrong. And stand together, objecting to that which destroys the whole. So, okay, I didn't know what I was going to say here, and 3 days ago I was called by Krishnam to find some very appropriate people to speak. Unfortunately, they were unavailable in New York, so I'm replacing them. But I have talked to lots of them. These are fellow directors. I talked to literally hundreds of directors and have for the last 25 years. And the idea about why people become filmmakers, specifically become filmmakers, and some of the ones who we admire most, is because I really believe they want to express a way for us to rethink who we are and to potentially make our world a healthier space. I've been very fortunate. I've been fortunate because I haven't had to do what most filmmakers have to do with their lives, is make distractions. And think about it, most of the media we watch is distractions. I've been lucky. So I quickly picked, actually yesterday, a couple of clips from some of the images that I've made over the last almost four decades to at least stimulate maybe me in conversation for a couple minutes. So let's take a look and see what they're like. These are from about five or six different films over the last number of years.
This man was on a boat and fell into the sea, and the captain of the boat, he saw this man was drowning, so he threw this man a rope. And hold on to this rope, he shouted. Hold on to this rope, hold tight, hold tight, because if you let go, you may lose your life. Are we too not drowning in the sea of ignorance, cruelty, death? Who is our captain? God.
And what is the rope that he throws us?
Colonists arrived from their diverse backgrounds from all through Europe with their divergent religious beliefs, and yet they had to fight to secure their religious freedom.
The defendant, Abbott Hoffman.
The jury is directed to disregard the kiss thrown by the defendant Hoffman, and the defendant is directed not to do that sort of thing again.
But here we were, grown up in the late 50s with the whole idea of material success, the designer brain mentality. We could have credit cards if we wanted. We could have good paying jobs. We didn't have to worry about keeping up with Mr. Jones because we were Mr. Jones. And we said no to that primetime culture. We just said, chuck it.
Oh, yes, I studied in India and Japan. I studied mantra yoga, meditation exercise, sitting quietly, breathing exercises to quiet the body and calm the mind.
Did you have any occasion to meet with Abbie Hoffman?
Yeah.
Do you recall what Mr. Hoffman said in the course of conversation?
He said that politics was becoming theater and magic, that it was the manipulation of imagery through the mass media that was confusing and hypnotizing the people in the United States, making them accept a war which they really didn't believe in.
I don't know. Haven't you ever thought about it? Heaven, I mean.
Heaven. Well, you see, we don't really have heaven. Not exactly.
Thomas Jefferson said something. He wrote a letter to the Jewish community. Said something quite extraordinary. He said, when it comes to matters of religion in this nation, united we fall, divided we stand.
Nice quote. I didn't know that quote. You know, as a protective filmmaker, the tops of all the heads in this projection were cut off. So of course, part of me is thinking, oh, well, that's terrible. It's not being shown right. And then I thought, well, the tops of all the heads are being cut off. Maybe there's something appropriate about that. Because what really gets in our way? I know what gets in my way is the phrase, the chattering monkey of my head, finding all kinds of things wrong and criticizing myself and making myself very stressed out. And yet, if I open up that head to all of you, then there's the possibility that the kind of images that I will foster in the students who are among us here will be those that actually make a difference. As you heard, we have something now at the School of Cinematic Arts called the Change-Making Media Lab, which is specifically devoted to making films that make a difference. For the first time at the university, we're teaching a film course called Media for Social Change. And every one of the filmmakers in this class is making a short film about something that they either want to change awareness of or actually affect people and make a change in their lives. Film has the possibility of, as with many things, being used in a way that essentially is divertive and distractive, as I said, or it has the possibility of inspiring. And I hope the conversation that we have in the next number of minutes or in this lifetime is how we can use media to make a difference. So thank you. Now, Doctor, if you have a question and I have another minute, you can ask it.
Our next presenter is Jason Pollock. He is the founder of Boom Content. He is a filmmaker, writer, and digital producer. He has worked as a producer for a number of celebrities and organizations, including Ashton Kutcher, Michael Moore, and Rock the Vote. He was ranked in the top 140 most influential pages on Twitter in a report in the New York Times. PC Magazine listed him as one of the top 100 people to follow on Twitter. His documentary, The Youngest Candidate, which follows four teens running for public office in America, was the first documentary to be produced by David Letterman's company, Worldwide Pants. His new film about the education system is being produced by filmmaker Adam McKay, who directed the criminally underrated Will Ferrell film, Step Brothers. I encourage you all to see it if you haven't. Please join me in welcoming Jason Pollock.
Good evening. Step Brothers is actually a really great underrated film. Check it out. There is a sleepwalking scene in it that is one of the funniest scenes in any movie I've seen in a decade. So I'm sure you're all wondering, why is this child up here with these amazing people? It is truly inspiring and honoring to be here with you all tonight, and I thank you so much for inviting me. So I'll give you a little background of who I am, and hopefully my story connects well with human values and media. I decided to drop out of college when I was 19. I was at the UW-Madison, and I didn't understand how astronomy prerequisites were gonna help me be a better filmmaker. And I had the impatience of youth, which we were speaking about earlier, which I still have very much. And so I decided to leave, and I moved back to New York City, where I grew up in. I grew up in Connecticut, and I started taking PA jobs. 2 years later, I had the opportunity to interview to be Michael Moore's personal assistant in 2003, a month after he gave his infamous Oscar speech. I was a huge fan of Michael's, and I got the job. I think I got the job because Michael is also a college dropout, and I saw a lot of the people that I beat for the job, and they all had master's degrees, and they went to film school. Sorry, guys. But I do think that we connected on an unusual level because we came from the same kind of background. So in that instance, being a college dropout actually helped me. But it's not anything I'm proud of, though, to be honest. So that was 2003, and I was his personal assistant for 3 years. I made Fahrenheit with him. I was with him every day. It won the Palme d'Or in France, and it really was a game changer in many ways for media, using media to influence culture, and using media in an election cycle to influence the debate. And to be able to see it from a bird's eye view with Michael that year was obviously life-changing. We went to 60 cities in 30 days to get the youth vote out in 2004. And that was, you know, really inspiring for me too. And I think that I'll have to be on tour every election cycle pretty much for the rest of my life because of it. In 2005, I was still with him. Katrina happened, and Michael asked me if I wanted to go down to New Orleans to film and help with relief work. And I said, okay. I was there for 35 days right after the storm. This was before social media, really, but Michael had a mailing list. So we decided to put out a big message to our mailing list and say, you know, anyone in America who wants to go down to the hurricane, come down. Michael said he's sending his crew down there. We're going to set up a camp and, you know, we'll see what happens. So over 300 people came through the internet in 2005 just because of a mailing list letter. And we built this huge camp, and every day for 35 days, I gave food and supplies to someone who had not gotten food and supplies, even on the 35th day, which was really sad. So I saw very, very early on how the power of the internet could really influence change, as well as the power of media. And when Michael was doing these things, when we were working on these things in 04 and 05, it wasn't really mainstream yet. It wasn't really cool. You know, there weren't classes in colleges all around social justice films yet. And I think, you know, I give Michael a lot of credit for, you know, really starting a lot of that in many ways. So in 06, I had been his assistant for 3 years, and I was really eager. I'd been someone's assistant for 5 years at this point. I highly suggest any of you that are going into film to be someone's assistant for a really long time. I learned more during that period than I could ever have learned if I had tried to do my own thing. You know, to have a mentor in life is really, really valuable, and to have a very smart mentor is really valuable. And the only way to get that kind of real close mentor relationship is to be someone's apprentice. So I highly recommend that. In 06, I moved out to LA. I wanted to direct my first documentary. I didn't know exactly what I wanted it to be, but I wanted it to be about the youth vote. So I started pitching a youth vote documentary in 06, and everyone's like, that issue isn't going to be that big of a deal in 08. And then this guy named Barack Obama started getting popular. So my film idea started getting more popular, and this guy named Lawrence Bender, who is Quentin Tarantino's producer and the producer of An Inconvenient Truth, signed on to produce my film in 07. And then David Letterman's company, after Lawrence signed on, they signed on, and I started production, moved back to New York. I made The Youngest Candidate in 07 and 08. It's a documentary about teenagers that run for political office in America, and I really wanted to use it as a tool in the 08 election, kind of using that Fahrenheit model, but in a nonpartisan way, and creating a conversation around the youth vote in 2008. So I was able to finish the film, and I took it on a 21-city screening tour to colleges in battleground states, and talked with high school kids and college kids and showed them the film. So we're going to play a trailer of that right now, I think.
I had no idea.
I did not know that 18-year-olds could run for office in America.
You don't want to be like a loser and think like you go home and watch the news, like you know all this stuff about politics. But that's not fitting in. That's like, you're weird.
I knew I did not want to be involved in the high school atmosphere anymore. Pretending that I cared about people's shoes and people's hair, I didn't care.
We were from the projects. Everybody had to struggle every single night to come up with food.
Either they'll rob us, they'll break in, there were shootings.
I remember seeing my first dead body, like in this corner.
I've lived in 10 different cities, from Los Angeles to Atlanta, Georgia, Trenton, New Jersey.
When I was 10 years old, my parents got divorced. My father was an alcoholic, and my mother couldn't take it anymore. In the long run, I couldn't really get along with my mother very well, and eventually I became estranged from my mother as well. As far as my childhood goes, it was a complete and utter disaster.
We can do whatever we want, and we can do it at a young age. You know, you're told you can be whatever you want to be. The moment I tried to be everything that I could be, half the people that tell you that are like, you're not ready, and you're not this, and you're not that.
This is his major
home.
What's the largest toy in inches that you have?
Do we want the 18-year-old, do we want the woman who played with dildos on TV?
As an 18-year-old that some call inexperienced, I do have the answers, however.
Patronage, corruption, cronyism.
Atlantic City Councilman Timothy Mancuso has been arrested for drinking and driving on a beach in a city-owned vehicle.
It's time to end it.
I'm not sure whether she really recognizes the realities of budgets, labor contracts.
She'd be coming in completely blind to what goes on.
This is what I've been waiting for 8 months.
Told those people that you did 2 years.
That's because you just ruined. I want to win this election, and I'm not going to win it as a 19-year-old.
But you can't win it as a liar.
Somebody's going to tell me something. That's the bottom line.
Alamo Studio.
That son of a bitch will shit snakes before it's over with.
Feel a little nauseous.
I'm drinking.
I guess this is what it's like whenever you put yourself out there.
Go take my photograph.
But can I just see your stomach real quick? Because I want to see if he's got a bomb.
Why would you say that?
Because he's Indian.
Those were complete words.
Sadie's was saying that George is playing into the white man. You said you agree with that.
I'm not talking to you about that.
We still fight.
I don't know if that's legal, what we just did.
All of you are criminals.
This doesn't want to let me go.
What is porn station?
I don't know what the hell's going to happen.
Only those who dare to fail greatly can ever achieve greatly.
So I slept on couches for about 5 years to make that happen. I finished in 08, and everyone patted me on the back, and they're like, great job, kid. Really great job. And they were done, and I realized very quickly that if I didn't continue to sleep on couches, that no one was ever going to see this. So at the beginning of 09, I decided to not take a job and to continue working on the marketing, publicity, and distribution of this film, which we had no budget for, and I had no idea how to do any of that. And so out of desperation of just wanting people to see my baby, I taught myself social media throughout 09 and kind of became like an idiot savant at it. Like, I don't really understand why I've adopted to this medium so much, but I have. So by June of 09, I finally got the film into the LA Film Festival, and I had 60,000 followers on Twitter and had connected with most of the early celebrity influencers on Twitter. And literally through Twitter, Ashton Kutcher like reached out and offered me a job at his company. So if anything is possible. And I really saw how the power of social media is really a game changer. Like, Ashton ran against CNN to be the first person to 1 million followers that year. And I was a big supporter of that race, even though I didn't know him, because I felt like that race was a good metaphor to the world who didn't quite understand what was going on in 09, that people are becoming more powerful than networks because of the internet. And it really is a democratizing force around the world. So the film, I worked for Ashton for 6 months from the end of 09, the beginning of 2010. He's a brilliant man running a huge enterprise at 34 years old, and it was incredible to see that at work. In 2010, I started pitching my new documentary, which I wanted to be about the education system. And because of Waiting for Superman had just gotten out, and people were like, well, there's a big documentary about education out right now. So it didn't really happen. So I just kept going at it. Finally, a week after Labor Day 2011, so literally a year and a half later, Adam McKay, who's Will Ferrell's business partner, the co-owner of FunnyOrDie.com, director of Anchorman, Talladega Nights, Step Brothers, and the other guys, four of my favorite comedies ever, and he's directing Anchorman 2, decided to jump on and attach himself as producer of the film, which is a big deal for education in this country, that someone with his clout is gonna help me produce the film. And really what I'm doing with this film is I'm calling it a social media documentary. You know, we're at a point now in our time where the internet gives us this incredible opportunity to do things that have never been done before. Especially with social now, we can literally use these tools in ways that they've never been used before. And so what I'm trying to do is create a case study and something that people can point to along the history of documentary filmmaking and say, that one really changed things. So I'm calling my my film a social media documentary, and I'm coining that phrase. And what I'm going to do is run a social media campaign in schools throughout America for the year. And while I'm running that campaign, I'm also going to be making a documentary. And they're going to happen at the same time. And that's never happened before, which is crazy to say, but it actually hasn't. So like most social media campaigns launch a documentary or they're after a documentary. Like Bully, the movie Bully is a great example. That's a great film. But they didn't start social media 2 years ago. They started it too late. They started it now. Kony 2012 is a great video, but it launched a campaign. It wasn't together. So what I hope to do with this is fuse these two new mediums together and kind of create a documentary in a new way, essentially. And everyone that you have 100,000 followers online now, and all those people that are going to be watching my clips and being a part of this production experience, I hope that they feel closer to this content because they really, in a very real way, are going to help me make it. And I think that, you know, that's kind of what these tools are allowing us to do now is, you know, involve people and make them feel closer to us in a very, very real way. And so I would pose a question to all of you is, in your lives, what your projects are, you know, how can you use these tools in a way that nobody has ever used them before? And that's actually very possible and very doable. So I thank you so much for your time. So honored to be here. Thank you.
Our final presenter is Norman Seif. He graduated with honors in science and art at King Edward VII School in Johannesburg, South Africa. He qualified as a medical doctor in 1965 and for 3 years worked as an emergency medicine in Soweto, focusing on the management of traumatic shock. He relocated to the U.S. to begin his career as a rock photographer, a very different trajectory. He is the former creative director of United Artists Records, and over the years, his photographs have achieved an iconic status, revealing an authenticity that's unique and timeless. His pictures have been featured on the covers of Interview, Rolling Stone, and Time magazine, as well as numerous books. From 2000 onwards, he applied his unique process to exploring and defining the creative vision of corporate clients such as Paramount Television, the California Institute of Technology, and NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. The latter led to his emotionally powerful documentary, Triumph of the Dream, which is scheduled for release in 2012. Please join me in welcoming Norman Seif.
As a filmmaker, I have to say to the cameraman, are you okay if I'm over here? Okay. When we were sitting in the room with Guruji, I asked Guruji, do you have a direction that you'd like to take this event? And he said, using his words, just be spontaneous. So I have no idea where I'm going to go, but I actually am so excited to be able to do what I do when I work with artists. So I have to be very careful that I don't talk too long because we have a film that's about 9 minutes long. But I want to just describe the process that was a paradigm shift for me coming out of medicine. And at that time, emotions in the physiology book had two lines. And those two lines were, emotions are an epiphenomenon of physical changes in the body. And that was the end of it. Imagination was considered wasting time and weak because you failed. Hope as an energy of initiation was also basically, oh, poor thing, you know, you failed, and all you have is hope. So, and I just want to jump back to a little piece that's just come to me, because in the end, what I'm experiencing is that I'm on a journey that is constantly challenging and new, and it doesn't have an end. And that was also one of the paradigms in the early days, that we always thought things had a beginning, a middle, and an end. So just to describe a little picture, which I'll come back to, but I remember standing at the bedside of patients, and I would always feel like the need to put my hands on them, either hold an arm, or if someone had some pain, I would put my hand on the on where they said they had pain. And very often people would say, gee, I don't know what it is, doctor, but actually I'm feeling a little better. And what I did with that is I just went, oh, great, sure, you know. And basically the kind of medicine that I was doing was frontline, traumatic, painful, soul-destroying fixing. There was no healing. There was fixing going on. And so cut, I had a whole story in between there, but cut to the work that I do now, what I found as I started to work with artists that actually the foundation of communication and the foundation of relationship is emotion-based. And we were told, don't be emotional because you won't be able to be objective with your patients. So I find that I'm illiterate. The other part of it is that everything that I'm doing is based on imagining possibilities. And I actually realize that I'm in shock. I'm also terrified when I'm working with artists because I realize that it's not about trying to aim for a goal, but if I can create an experience and then I just document the experience, what will come out of that experience will be an authentic capturing of something that's real. And I really didn't know how to do that because when I looked at it, the only way that I could be real was to be in touch with my emotions. So for many years dealing with the fear at the beginning of a photo session, I realized that I had to come to terms to be able to be emotionally vulnerable in that moment. So one of the things that was a turning point for me one day when I finally was vulnerable enough with an artist to say, you know, I'm really scared, I don't know where I'm gonna go. And they looked at me and they said, gee, you know, I'm really scared and I don't know where I'm gonna go. And I found instantaneously we were in an intimate, trusting relationship. So my whole paradigm switched from aiming at trying to get a shot to creating an environment of trust. And let's put it this way, an environment of emotional authenticity. And out of the emotional authenticity, the trust would emerge. And if I was asking artists to be real and to be spontaneous with me, they had to be willing to let go, and they would only let go if they trusted the situation. Excuse me for one second. So my work became focused now on discovering this paradigm shift, which was emotions are at the core of the communication process. Imagination is the source of creativity, feminine energies, imagination, emotion. That was the power. The emotions were the juice. And also that the process didn't work in a linear way. It worked in quantum leaps of insight. So that whole model, that chauvinist model of the masculine is will and action, get out there and do, just do it as a model, was completely turned upside down for me. So what I've been involved with now since those early days is understanding more and more that we are involved in an absolutely profound global paradigm shift. And there is the chauvinist model of domination and control, which was the way I thought I could be safe in the early days, denigrating emotions, denigrating imagination. Those systems are beginning to collapse, and there's an enormous amount of chaos. And as we were talking, Jeremy and I earlier, what I'm saying is that the chaos, in fact, is the harbinger of change. And it can be celebrated. The whole point about chaos is that it's this incredibly beautiful, fragile energy, and depending upon how you observe it, it can go either way. If you observe it through the observing devices of pessimism and anger and rage and just the pain in the world, you can shift that energy, which is the energy of all possibility. Or you can observe it through the joy and the love and the the passion, and then you shift it another way. So what I got was that the reality is based on how I observe my world. If I observe it in one way, I precipitate it into a particular reality. If I can shift my observing devices, I literally shift the reality that I observe. I'm not just changing my attitude to what I'm observing, I literally change what I observe. There's a precipitation that is different because I observe it differently. So all of this is at the backdrop of the way that I work with public personalities. And I'm going to show you a little piece that I started filming my sessions in 1975. The first session I filmed was with Ike and Tina Turner, a very seminal moment. They were geniuses. They worked together very beautifully. They also, as you know, had issues later on. But what I discovered when I watched that film was that the emotionality and the dynamics of the interaction could be captured on film. And I knew instantaneously that that was a medium for me to start to explore what I now call exploring the inner dynamics of the creative process, because it's an inside job, to quote my wife, Sue. I have to make sure that I'm giving credit where credit is. And it's all an inside job. And so I'm involved in this beautiful, profound inside job. I have access to some of the greatest creators, innovators, who are working at the higher reaches of human potential. And what I get is that they observe reality through this higher potential motivation. They are passionate, they are vulnerable, they're motivated by love, even though this society doesn't allow you to say those words with a kind of an acceptance. But the creative process for me, and as I work with artists, the artists who are engaged in the creative process, they are putting love into the world, and they are also healing the world. And so what I should do now actually is shut up. And get off and let the film show. I just want to say very quickly what this is. One of the things that I found, because I discovered that I was terrified at the beginning of the session, and I thought that's something wrong with me, therefore I'm definitely not a natural artist. What I discovered later on, that in fact, if you're going to jump into the unknown, which is the foundation of innovative creativity, you better be scared. And if you're not scared, you're probably not jumping into the unknown. So the idea there is all creation begins in the mind as a dream. I call it the emergence of the dream. That's an idea. And what comes up at the next step is the resistance to the dream. I have a dream. I'm going to do this. Oh, shit. Okay? And so that resistance is actually fear on an emotional level. And then it gets down to how do I raise the money and sleep on a couch and live my life. So there's practical challenges and emotional challenges. But this is pretty self-evident as you look at it. And the short piece of film that I'll show you, you will see this dynamic in action. And I'm fascinated now with unraveling the dynamics of the creative process. This is not a theory of creativity. These are the stepping stones, the dance that one can do. And it's the beginning of a series of workshops that we hope to be bringing out towards the end of the year. But at this point, let's start the film. Thank you. So you're comfortable with a certain amount of uncertainty?
Oh, absolutely.
You have to be.
Yeah, you have to be.
The way I describe it to people in the business we are in exploration, you have to have your head in the clouds, but you have to have your feet on the ground. If we push the limit and fail, that should not intimidate us.
Right.
Because if we get too intimidated by failure, then we'll shy away from pushing the limit. And failure should be looked at as something to learn from, not something to be afraid of.
You remember when suddenly you had the idea of how it could work?
Yeah, I was at home. It was my birthday.
What were you doing?
I think I was laying in bed. I was going to go to sleep, and I couldn't go to sleep because I didn't have the answer.
You wake up at 5 a.m.
Yeah.
What's the thought?
The first thought is, I'm frustrated. I can't make this work. The next thought is, wait a minute. There's another way.
When do those conceptual solutions come to you?
I can remember the moment perfectly clear. I was sitting in my office and I put up a drawing of the lander with the rover on top and sort of just forced myself to literally to visualize the rover sitting on top of the lander, visualizing in my mind, how is this rover gonna get off?
And then the ideas just started flowing. I mean, by 6 o'clock in the morning, I knew what I wanted to do. I'm waiting, I'm watching the clock.
And I think to myself, all right, I'm on the surface of Mars, I'm the rover, I gotta get off. How's it gonna happen? What is the simplest, stupidest, most obvious thing that can happen here?
I said, that's it, that's what we gotta do.
And that came all in 1 minute?
Yeah.
Suddenly you had a picture in your mind.
Right.
And what happened? Did you go to sleep?
No.
Okay, what happened then?
And I think, oh my God, how are we gonna do this?
I just instantly saw it on the drawing, I saw it on the lander, I saw it on Mars. It was so obvious that, of course, it had to work, and it did.
That need to express, huge.
Is it huge for me? It's very huge for me.
Did you know you had a voice?
I knew I had a voice, but I didn't quite put the two together until a long while later.
The first inkling to you that this was a destiny.
I actually remember that exact point.
When I got to college and I started with electrical engineering, then at the end of my second year, I changed my major because I decided that I was fooling myself. And I looked in the mirror one day and said, who are you trying to kid? You know you have no choice. You have to go through that door of being a musician.
I went home that night and I sat there and I just, for the first time ever, consciously or unconsciously at that moment, I just wrote, I said what I felt and I played what I felt and I just didn't give any thought to anything. I didn't care if it was technically correct. I didn't care if my fingers were in the correct position. I wasn't thinking at all. I just wrote what I felt and what that drew me to remember and think about and feel, honestly.
I changed my major to music composition and I got my Bachelor of Arts in music composition.
This is you discovering in that moment the future of your voice.
Mm-hmm.
And what you did, you put the arms of creativity around yourself.
And then I gave myself a big hug.
Yeah.
And then
all hell broke loose.
That's where it began.
And then your fulfillment comes out of this.
That's it, I always did. You know what, it's one of the things I learned in rehab, that this was not first on my priority list, and it disturbed me greatly to find out that music had become not first.
So you made a choice in that moment.
Yeah.
That's what I call a fundamental choice, which changes your life. That choice point, because there's always on the journey, there's always the call, and then there's a point where the fear comes up.
Exactly. I was scared, but at this point, the desire and the drive was stronger than the fear. I was either going to do it and succeed or do it and fail. There was no not doing it.
But you were willing to go.
I was willing to go.
All instruments whip you, because sometimes they won't do what you want them to do.
Uh-huh.
Of course, the instrument will say, no, it ain't me, it's you.
Right.
The instrument talks back. You never can overwhelm an instrument. All you can do is get to the, you can bring yourself to your own competence.
Uh-huh.
But there's always more left in the instrument.
Yeah.
Do you understand what
I mean? Sure.
You will never get out all of this piano what's in it.
Yes,
absolutely. An instrument can bring you to your limits.
Yeah, but I mean, isn't that really what creativity in a sense is about?
Yeah, if you can think of it.
Right.
See, that's the key.
Right.
You know, make it, to create it in your mind.
It's the tool for transformation.
Yes, yes. You got it. That's a great way to put it. See, now why not think of that?
And it's interesting because everything emerges in the mind. in an internal process within the imagination.
Oh, yeah.
And at a certain point, you need to sit down and come to a consensus and say, okay, here is how we're going to do it.
Yeah.
That becomes a turning point where the decision is made.
Yeah.
We are going to go forward with this particular strategy.
And that's hard. That part is really hard because the way these things go, there's always another idea out there. There's always a way to make it better.
And you're scared because this is putting your ass on the line in a certain sense.
Oh, it's putting the whole project on the line.
Okay.
And you know, there were many steps along the way where we had to commit to a certain way of doing things. But when the time comes to make the decision, you make it and you don't look back.
You jump.
Seeing the lander in the rearview mirror of the rover was the reason why I did it all. I knew that that was the moment.
And what happened then?
Lost it. Not ashamed of it at all.
Yes, unashamedly, you were real in that moment.
And I get teary-eyed every time I think about it. My brother Mike, I think, you know, gave me the reinforcement, what I needed to, I guess, put that moment in perspective. And he told me that we should all be so fortunate to work on something that moves us to tears.
That it touches your soul.
And it still does.
You know, dreams are possible. In order to make a dream become reality, you have to bring it from that dream state to a reality state. So how do we bring that combination of dreamers and implementer, so we can dream of things and then make them happen.
But your personal tendency is more can do than cannot do.
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely. I mean, my first reaction on everything that it's feasible.
Right.
Yeah, we can do it.
Goldstone has a carrier signal in lock from the rover.
So you're in bed and you're on fire.
Yeah.
Correct. This is your birthday. What's the date?
April 3rd.
What year?
2000.
So April 3rd, 2000, on your birthday, you're lying in bed and you get an idea. That correct?
That's right.
And now it's walking on Mars.
Yeah, it sure is.
How does that feel?
It's surreal. It is really surreal. I mean,
the power of a dream. I mean, isn't it? I mean, it was a waking dream, thinking about Mars.
Thinking about how to get there.
Join us on stage. Christian. And ask you all to make sure your mics are on.
I heard the mic.
So thank you all for those really thought-provoking and really fascinating presentations. You've really given us a lot to think about and great material to talk about. I want to start with His Holiness. Guruji, as a Hindu, we're taught that the world is Maya, the world is illusion. When we look at the screen, we also see the world of illusion. What's the difference between watching a film on a screen and watching our own reality or the film of our own life?
You know, the rule for an actor is you should feel this act is very real. Then they'll be a good actor. They can bring the best out of it. You know? And the rule for best living is seeing everything as a dream, everything as a movie. Mm. Then you can act without being totally lost in it. Mm. So They're very complementary in some way. Actually, Maya means that which can be measured. The word measure comes from the Sanskrit root Maya, means to measure. All that we see can all be measured. What cannot be measured is the inner feelings. Love cannot be measured. Truth cannot be measured. Beauty cannot be measured. So these are the nature of the spirit which cannot be measured. Everything else in the world, which is made up of five elements, earth, water, fire, air and ether, can be measured. So this is called the world is Maya, which is ever changing, which is subject to measurement.
And Norman, if it really is the case that we project our own reality onto the world that we see, I'm fascinated by your perspective as a photographer, because photographs, in a way, are a type of autobiography. They help us create meaning and narrative in our own life. From your perspective, how do photographs help us tell stories about ourselves?
I read that question and I decided I wasn't going to answer
okay.
it, but please, but I will, because I use the medium of photography as a vehicle to do the inner work, and the same thing with film. And I just love what you just said, because just in my own evolution, as part of that, the Maya that I came from in the beginning was measure everything, try and understand it, make it mechanical. And as I got into the depth of the creative process, I realized I was dealing with fundamentals that could not be measured. And I had to, that's as you see on that piece of film, the first question is, you're comfortable with a certain amount of uncertainty. Mm-hmm. I wasn't, because I wanted to try and control it. And through the work that I did was, in a certain way, pushed to learn to live with uncertainty and that beautiful thing where there are no limits to. Those are the fundamental qualities, but I use the creative vehicle to get to that experience.
Hmm. Jeremy, in connecting the work that you do as a filmmaker with the world around you, the reality around you, I'm interested in, you know, obviously we've had a tragic week, and this is also the 20th anniversary of the LA riots, and there's a lot of talk about what is the role then of media in perpetuating or curbing violence. What do you think the connection is between media and violence, and how do you think of your own responsibility as a filmmaker in terms of propagating certain values?
Wow. I'm an associate over there, John Rodson. We're involved in a project right now that's been a project that's been around for me for around 40 years. And it's called Shot. And it's about what happens to an innocent bystander who gets shot. Mm-hmm. And what happens to the shooter, who's a 16-year-old kid who didn't mean to shoot him. And for 1 hour, we never leave either of these human beings. We stay with them for the entire experience. Now, I've never seen this before. You've probably been with people who've been shot, and you know the golden hour. It's called the golden hour. If you survive it, you might survive. Because one of the things we've done is we're inured to the emotion of some of the violence that we propagate continuously. We're inured to the wars that we fight that we don't want to fight, to the 240 million guns that are out there in this particular society at this very moment. Michael's brilliant movie, Columbine, speaking to this issue. So the question now becomes, can we take a piece of media and get those people who see it to experience something that is clearly physical pain, so that we begin to remind ourselves who we really are? What are we doing? Why are we doing this? The one thing that film can do is, and any theater can do, a theater is about this, it provides the possibility of me to identify with you who's on that screen, which just happened with the people that you just saw. It just happens with us right here. That's what film can do. So if we make this right, which we will do, because you're going to help us spread the word. We're going to get people to get more conscious of what it means to live in a gun culture. You know, some of you may know Bill Cosby a couple days ago said, this was not about race. And the two poor kids who died on our campus, it was not about race. It's about people who have guns. Can we change it? Well, if we put our energy, we can change anything. So film propagates guns, shows them violence, guns. I like those exciting movies. Give me lots of blow-ups and all the rest. And maybe we can also use film to stop it. So that's the responsibility we have.
Jason, most of the world is under the age of 30, and they're telling new stories about themselves. Technology, as you mentioned, has allowed young folks to move from being cultural consumers to cultural producers. And I think we saw this, you know, social media can be anything from, you know, what am I wearing today, to something as profound as the Arab Spring, where we saw the role of Twitter and Facebook in changing a regime. What inspires you about this generation in terms of their use of social media in telling new stories about themselves and about the world? And are there some examples that you can share
Absolutely.
With us?
Yeah. I'll speak a little bit about what Jeremy was speaking about. So I've been very involved in the Trayvon Martin online conversation. I try to get involved in as many of these online conversations as possible and help support which ones I believe in. I think the Trayvon Martin story is a very interesting case study. Even a few years ago, someone like Trayvon, who was gunned down, it would never have gotten out into the public eye. But because of social media now, if there's a story that isn't getting a spotlight, this new layer allows us to democratize in a new way and to get that story out there. And I think, you know, obviously the Arab Spring was the biggest boom of that. But I think Americans in many ways are complacent to the power of this online platform because we have so much freedom in this country that we forget how democratizing these tools really are. In other countries where they do not have freedoms of the press, of all these beautiful things that we have in America, they are immediately adapting to these tools and using them in the way that we can see that they can be done with. So I think that Americans are slowly seeing that. I think Occupy Wall Street is another good example of us, you know, using these tools to pull together to get a point across. The Kony 2012 video is another amazing case study of this. And regardless of if it was 100% accurate, it has made huge impacts already. The American government and African governments have already deployed troops looking for the guy simply because kids around America were passing around this video. So, you know, we've heard this term slacktivism a lot. Does a click really matter? Well, a click really matters. And we can see real effects all over the globe with that. So, you know, I think it's a very exciting time. And I think, you know, obviously young people are adopting to these tools in a rapid way. If any of you are trying to figure out what your major should be, or if you have kids and they're wondering, it should be computer science.
Guruji, we're talking about new media and cinema and television, which is all relatively new. But storytelling goes back thousands and thousands of years. It's as old as human history itself. When I was growing up learning about Hinduism in the US, I used to read Amar Chitra Katha comics about the great Indian epics like the Mahabharata and the Ramayana. Can you talk about the role of the epic traditions like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata and storytelling, and what sorts of values do they pass on through the generations?
You know, in those days, even 40, 50 years ago, when there was no television, these epics were the way of life. You know, if we find thousands of villages in the names of Rama, you know, not just in India, you go up to Japan. Till the end of Japan, you find these names prevalent. I mean, these stories have percolated. And each area has developed its own story, and which is still thrilling, which instills certain values. They were not just stories, but it carries some values for the youngsters, young generation. As you were just saying about the social media, today social media has become a way of telling stories about personal story to people. And it can also be a vehicle for disseminating values, having faith back in the values. For example, you know, recently in India we had this uprising on India against corruption. Mm-hmm. After IACI, I'm also one of the founding member of the India against corruption movement. So it's the Twitter and Facebook which has percolated through the whole society, irrespective of television media, could bring in people just in short period of time. Thousands could gather in a non-violent, peaceful manner and stand up against corruption. This has never happened before in such a big scale, where people have gathered, stood for a cause, because they have been inspired by values. Again, by Mahatma Gandhi's values, or non-violence and truth, and standing up for these values, you know. I feel the epics have played a role here too. It has ingrained that value. Yeah, we can stand up, and not a single incident of violence has happened in a country of 1.2 billion people. This is something that, you know, the credit goes to perhaps the epics, where you have been asked to stay away from violence, but do peaceful protests.
Norman, in your comments earlier, you talked about the difference between healing and fixing. You felt like you were fixing as a physician in South Africa. Have you found healing in the art that you do now, either for yourself or for your or for the artists or for the world who sees your work?
The fixing is basically at the mechanical level, and you may patch up a wound or treat someone's condition, and you send them out, and then they're back 4 months later, you know, with the same condition. Healing doesn't necessarily have to fix the body. It basically turns inward to an emotional change. So as I looked at, you know, it was interesting, as I said, I didn't hear emotionally when I was putting my hands on people that there was an energy in me that was a resonance of love, because I was so wounded in that environment, I was completely cynical about love. And now, years later, as I'm doing this work, I'm realizing that that's the inner motivation. And just by being with people, coming from that resonance, from that place of love, and interacting with them, change can take place. Change, which is healing, not necessarily fixing. So as I've now reassessed my true will, in a certain sense, in this lifetime, I realize even though I've got an identity as a photographer or now a documentary filmmaker, that basically, and it's embarrassing at one level to that part of me to say, no, I perceive myself as a healer. And it started with self-healing enough to heal the love, to be able to know that that is part of who I am, and just the presence of that is what we can all give each other as we enchant that aspect of ourselves. So as I said, the creators who are out there, out of the joy of what they do, they are shifting the resonance of the planet, and they are healers in that way. So that's the end of the sentence.
Okay. It's a good sentence.
It's a great sentence. Jeremy, we're on a spiritual journey, and you've thought deeply about cinema consciousness and human values in your personal life and in your professional life. What is the connection between human values and how did you, and your own spiritual journey? And can you talk about your own process as a filmmaker?
Wow. That's the second time I started my answer with wow. Yeah. I guess I struggle, well, okay. Sometimes a film project chooses you. Mm. And it may choose you for a reason you didn't even realize. Now, I happen to grow up as a I'm a son of a rabbi, but those of you who know anything about Judaism, he's a reform rabbi, which means he might as well, never mind. It means that the issue of the spirit was not part of the conversation. The issue of social justice was a constant part of the conversation. When I was little, the idea that we lived to be able to share and help other people, particularly those who were disadvantaged, that was your responsibility as a human being. I grew up with that. Didn't always act on it, I grew up with it. But I had no idea about the idea that there was such a thing as a spiritual existence. No, I'm talking about 1,500 of my families going down rabbis to me, but I had no idea what it meant. It didn't mean a thing to me. And that particular movie that you saw a clip of, which I didn't want to make, and it went after me and asked to be made by me over a 3-year period, because I turned it down once and then it reoccurred. And I got exposed to the fact that in my particular tradition, there is a great depth of mysticism and spirituality. I knew nothing about it. And suddenly, while making this movie, I found that there was an entire other way of looking at life. The movie taught me. So I then, and I sit here, what does these words, when you said spiritual, I remember one of the things that I've been trying to define what that means. What does spiritual mean? And on one side, I know from many kinds of experience, it is that which holds what is manifest in physical. But it has no definition. By having no definition, those of us who need to have things to hold on to, it's like, what do I do? I remember Ram Dass once said, and I heard him say, he said this line, he said, being free is having nowhere to stand. Mm. What does that mean? I'm standing here, and I'm just beginning to understand what that is. And it took a near-death experience, my own, to open up the possibility, because I'm a person who can think about it, but is it real for me, or is it just my mind thinking about it? And I'm sitting here honored to be in the presence of everybody, but particularly, your existence is a reflection of all of this for me right this second. And can I grasp it? And can I be it? And can I recognize, just not on an intellectual level, that in fact it is true right now? Can I do that? And of course. So the answer to the question is how to keep that dialogue going between the practical and the real, which is the spiritual.
Jason, we've talked about the great power of social media, the democratization, the liberating aspects, the self-empowering aspects. But in my work with college students, I also find that social media tends to be a distraction in some ways, and that I feel that sometimes students are there, but they're not really present because they're constantly checking all their updates. I think that a new study showed that the average student will check 27 different types of media within 1 hour while sitting on a computer. And I fear that our students are...
I just checked 3.
I fear that our students may have 500 friends on Facebook, but not any real friends. And I fear that the more they talk with their thumbs, the less they talk with their mouths. Do you see a downside to social networking in terms of being something that is spiritually disembodied?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely think there's a double-edged sword to everything. Food, drug, anything that we can, you know, consume. I think that students were checking 10 times, they were checking 27 things 20 years ago also. It might not have been these websites. Mm. And I think that attention span is more related to age than the media that is available to us. Having said that, you know, we need to be able to draw a fine line in the sand where, you know, we do things and we don't do things. You know, when I go to a meeting with someone, I very purposely do not pick up my cell phone the whole time. And that always kind of surprises people because I'm always tweeting when they're not with me, but when you are with me, you get me. And so having said that, though, I think that You know, I'm very inspired by the work of Steve Jobs, and I think that if you really want to make something great in this world, you have to isolate yourself. You know, you cannot run around and be worried about going to parties every night if you really want to build something great. So, I mean, in terms of the isolation factor, there's a double-edged sword to that as well. You know, and I don't remember who said this quote, but if you want people to listen to you, you have to learn to be alone with your thoughts. So, you know, I think in some ways, you know, the 140-character Twitterverse may be a bad side of it, but it also may be reinforcing these ideals that we really need to focus on our own thoughts and communicate well. And, you know, sitting in front of these computers gives us that way to do that. The other thing that's wonderful about the internet is that there's no color online. You know, there's not much diversity other than your avatar and your name. And so there's a lot more commonality there than differences in a very real way. I may not go out to parties every night, but I have real relationships with people all over the world that I've never met before through this wonderful medium. So, you know, I think we have to be responsible with it, but also encourage it.
Guruji, visual storytelling tends to draw us outward with the promise of fulfilling something inside of us. How can we find inner fulfillment through film and television and new media?
You know, the general experience of wonder or something so beautiful is you shut your eyes and say, oh, it's excellent. Even if you're having a donut or an ice cream, you know, the moment you take an ice cream, oh, that's fantastic. Whenever you say, oh, it's fantastic, automatically your eyes shut. So it says that's something that's so beautiful, so wonderful, is deep within. You know, when you repeat it, somehow it loses the charm. So whenever you like something and you keep repeating it, you don't find it anymore there. So always the joy or enjoyment is in the transition, when the mind is off one thing and is not yet used to the other thing. In between this, there is a certain gap where the mind comes in touch with that gap. But unfortunately, it links that pleasure to the following object. And then you gallop after the object and then you lose the taste. Even with the Twitter or movies, whatever the taste, but you know, if you are doing it over and over and again, there is a point of breakdown that comes that you get fed up with it. You don't want to do it anymore. That's where you need to retire, take some time off to yourself, as you correctly said, isolation. I would say you don't have to isolate with everything, but isolate in your mind. You can sit and just close your eyes, go deep within, do a few minutes of meditation. That retiring from activity to inner rest, and again retiring from rest, not be there all the time, and be dynamic in activity, brings that balance, the most needed balance. That, I feel, is the source of creativity.
I want to ask our three panelists the same question, and we'll start with Norman. Guruji has said that a deeper experience of our own nature can lead to a more powerful expression of human values within ourselves. What elements do we most need to be present in film or media in order for the viewer to be led into a higher state of awareness or a deeper experience of themselves?
The first thing I want to say is that I wish you guys could be sitting right here, because I'm sensing such a beauty of just peace and joy sitting next to you. So it's really an honor to be up here. It comes down to me to authenticity in myself, which comes down to another layer of being emotionally authentic, so that I can ultimately touch my heart, and so that I see through the eyes of my heart. And if we can do that, and I think it starts with ourselves, if we can do that through the media, I think it ripples out to the edge of the universe. It is a resonance, and we can have impact at a distance by doing the inner work and the inner change. So that's my journey. Mm.
Jeremy, same question. What elements need to be present in a film or a media project in order for the viewer to be led into a higher state of awareness or a deeper experience of themselves?
The elements in the film. Well, I guess the last part is the question for me, how to get a deeper awareness of oneself. Mm. What I really love that Guruji just said was a couple of minutes. I used to go through this thing about meditation. What if I don't do it for 20 minutes? It's not any good. And the idea that you're saying even a minute, even a second of, and I love the quote that you just gave us, Jason, about, you know, being with yourself, alone with your thought before you're going to finally listen. So there is this business of the business of no longer business and being able to come from a place that's not just about ego and me. One of the things that film can do is, in fact, create compassion. An actor becomes, I was just talking today to Oliver Stone about working with some of his actors, and an actor playing Nixon, and the actor or playing George W. Bush. I can't play George W. Bush. I hate the man. Absolutely hate the man. You're asking me to play him? And inevitably, the actor played him and found in him, with all of the failings, a human being. And this business of having compassion is, I think, one of the issues. Compassion for yourself, big deal. Tough enough for me, not for you, maybe for me. And then compassion for others. And that is, in fact, an experience that film can actually provide. So it's working from that. I think that's one of the places that I think we can change ourselves and others. You know, it's interesting. I just learned that Zimmerman, I didn't realize, I saw a photograph of him, and I realized how young he is. And it suddenly, because immediately he was the villain. He too is in the mix of this victim. And to have compassion for him too. And that's really tough. But I think that's also part of what we're all, if we're going to be what we can be, that's part of what we need to be able to do.
Thank you. Jason.
So I have two things. A lot of it has, when I watch a film now, especially as someone who makes them all the time, I see that there's a heart that comes through in the films that we love. And that heart that comes through is based on the joy that the director and his crew had when they were making it. And if you do not have that pure joy with your crew and yourself, if this isn't a project, you know, I can't take on a project that I don't want to dedicate 5 to 6 years of my life to, because that's how long these things take, really. And so when you see something that someone who made it committed to that in their creative process, when they made that commitment, I think it resonates, and it has nothing to do with the actors on the screen or the editing or the shooting, but it's really about the joy that each of those people took in creating this thing that you see. And that is unspoken, but I think it's very real. And the other thing I think a lot of it has to do with is how much listening the filmmaker did before making the film. I think listening in this world is underrated and underdone, and the more we listen, the more fine-tuned our message can become. With social, I say, like, every tweet I send, I've read 1,000 tweets. And that's very true. And I think when we see a film that really resonates with us, it's because the filmmaker spent a lot of time listening before showing you what he or she thinks.
I'm going to ask one more question to the panel, and then we'd open it up for a conversation. And Christian, I'll ask if there's a handheld mic. Maybe we can get that for the Q&A. And I'll start with Guruji. The question is, each of you, in the work that you do and in your art, are expressing a personal vision for what the world might be. As we sit here in this room, what collaborative vision of the world can we create together? And quite simply, what would a world powerfully inspired by human values look like, in your perspective?
My dream is to see the world which is free from stress and violence, where there is no prejudice. I usually say, put it like this, of course it's too ambitious. A violence-free society, disease-free body, stress-free mind, inhibition-free intellect, trauma-free memory, sorrow-free soul. And I find this is the, I feel that this is the birthright of every human being. See today how cell phone has reached all over the globe. Every nook and corner you find cell phones today. Social media has reached. Can't we reach the education about one's own emotion? How to deal with one's own emotions? See, neither in school nor at home anyone teaches us how to deal with the negative emotions. It's natural to get agitated. It's natural to get upset or angry. But we live with it without knowing how to get over them and live in the present and come back and smile again like a child. As a baby, we have done this. As a child, we were crying and the tears are still on our cheek and we started smiling. It didn't take as much time to smile back again. But now if you are upset, it takes months together to come back to your smile. So we lack this education of coming to the present, coming to the now. Perhaps through social media and through cinema, movies, if this message could come back to people that life is an amalgamation of so many things, some pleasant, some unpleasant, and sail through them with a smile. When this message gets to people, I think we can have a better world, a world free from corruption. Again, here, corruption, I feel, begins where belongingness ends. Nobody practices corruption with people whom they think they belong to them. And today, Africa, when there are so many millions are dying, the rulers are stacking all their billions of dollars in London or Frankfurt or somewhere else. So, same with in India also, scams after scam, India is caught up between, though it's such a spiritual country, it's caught in between scam and slums. There is scam India and there is slum India. And it is this value education or value that wakes up within an individual can put an end to these disasters that the world is facing today.
Norman, what's your personal vision of what the world should be as manifest through your art? And what does a world inspired by human values look like for you?
Well, I don't think I have any expansion on what Guruji has said, but I do want to say one thing that in his opening statements where he looked at the audience and said, can you vision this world with me? And what I'd like to add to that is, yes, we can if we re-enchant our imagination and be able to imagine this world. When he said maybe it's too ambitious, I don't want to make it too ambitious. I would like to be able to say, yes, we can absolutely exercise that kind of vision and hold it, because one of the things that I know out of my creativity, if you can't imagine it, you will not create it. So that's really what I would like to add, that we can envision beyond the boundaries that we can currently hold. That's another vision of superseding who we think we are. And so I would love to join you in envisioning this new world.
Jeremy?
Ditto. But I have a question, Guruji.
Yeah.
Those people who are so selfish, I'm looking at Assad now in this in Syria right this moment, or the people who know they're corrupt in India right now, how do we transform them?
They just need to know that there is a greater joy in giving. We are all born with the infant joy of grabbing. As kids, we loved to grab things and we were happy. But as grandfathers and grandmothers, there is a joy in sharing. Poor things, they have never been educated in the joy of sharing. So they need that education. I have compassion for these people. They don't know there is an inner fear, insecurity or whatever. That's why they're stuck. They don't know the power of love. They don't know the power of compassion. They don't know what great joy it is to share with everybody.
Jason.
That was so beautiful. I think that the planet is involved in a cycle of low expectations right now. Working at inner city schools, that is the number one thing. These kids don't have any expectation that they can succeed. And that it is so simple to change that, to make them believe, to raise their bar and make them believe that they can, you know, expect higher from themselves. You know, America ending the NASA program to me is very difficult because that's a big source of innovation and inspiration that we've kind of taken away. But I think we need to really, you know, give platform to those that are still pushing the boundaries, trying to innovate. You know, inventing is really what has made us such a great people. And I think we've lost that a little bit. So we should try to bring it back.
Absolutely. Before we go into Q&A, I just want to give our panelists one last opportunity to express, well, we'll thank them, but just to express any last sort of comments that they might have, reflections that they might have on our topic of cinema, consciousness, media, and human values. And we'll start with Jeremy and just work our way down. Do you have any final thoughts that you'd like to leave us with before we go into Q&A?
No final thoughts, but a thought, which is that if we begin to demand that the people who control the avenues of media be responsible, I think we can see a change in how media functions for us. But that means, and I really appreciate, Jason, a lot of what you're speaking to, because we can demand it. And I hope that we start to do that so that we are not just receiving the junk that has made profits for a very few. It's time we said, let's change that now. Let's make it serve us. The airwaves are all of ours. So I'm actually talking more about that form of communication than cinema, but even there too. So I hope we take responsibility and say we want the media to be responsible.
Norman? Just listening to this group, I think there's pieces in the answer to that from everyone. I love the idea of being able to function out of the compassion for the pain. That's the separation that people feel. And to re-enchant, again, that desire to explore. So there's just something in there that's just eluding me for one moment. Oh. For me, the pain is the separation. And when we are separated from those, that joy of giving or that experience of love, that's pain. And so the separation has happened that people are not listening to each other and we're not dialoguing with each other. We've got, there's sort of dogmas going on and people entrenching. So. As a filmmaker and as a communicator, I don't want to be falling into that trap where I get judgmental and I lose my compassion. So to bring all of these qualities together, I think we can, by creating that new way of listening to each other, we can actually open the doors for people to not be coerced into change, but to invite them in to the change because they see something that touches something they've lost inside of them.
Media has a dual role to play. One is to keep the fact in front of people, the way it is. At the same time, it could be very depressive if you keep the fact, oh, there is so much crime, or, and then, you know, someone looks at it, and then they feel that can't do anything. You know, the sense of disparity and helplessness media can create this. So to balance this, to check this, media also have to create a hope. So one is to keep the fact as they are in front of people. Second is to create a hope in them so that they get enthused to act in a positive manner and imbibe human values as such. So this dual role have to be played in media around the world. Of course, social media does help, but the general media also have to bring this. You know, films can all be not only violence and sex and violence and crime, but it also need to inculcate values. Of course, America has produced some of the most wonderful movies to inculcate values through lions and, you know, the King Lion and movies like that. Lion King, the Lion King, a lot of wisdom has infiltrated into young minds, no doubt. But more has to be done in this direction. Even in video games, you know, video games is another thing that that makes you immune to violence. You know, when you're shooting so many times in a video game and taking a gun and shooting somebody doesn't feel like it's a crime. It feels like a game. So that fine-tuning need to be done in society, the balance between the fact and the dream. Thank you.
Thank you so much again for everything. I do believe in manifestation and through positive thinking and gratitude. Can't believe I'm sitting here tonight, and I always talk about that. I think if we truly do want to manifest something, our thoughts are really the road to lead us there. In terms of the media and the responsibility that it has, it does play a dual role, but if you have a problem with it, because of the things that have happened now, you are the media, we are the media, and we have to take responsibility for that. We make these celebrities through our clicks, through reading the blogs. So if you're upset about someone being famous, make someone else famous, and like, we really do have that power now.
That's great. The patron saint of our city, Walt Disney, said, if you can dream it, you can do it. And most of us feel like we can't do it, but oftentimes that's because we haven't dreamt it first. And I think that is what our panelists have discussed today. So please join me in giving a warm, warm round of applause to our esteemed panelists. The hour is getting late. We'll have time for two or three questions. Christian has the microphone. I asked that we have questions, right, not there, sermons, and we'll start with Rabbi Ruth Sharon.
I'm a documentary filmmaker, actually, and an interfaith activist, and this has been an extraordinary evening. The gems of everything that you all contributed will be with me for a long time. And if we're in a paradigm shift, I can't help but ask this question, why are there no women on the stage?
Yes.
And although you all have very highly expressed feminine sides to you, for which I'm very grateful, but you know what's happening in the news about the war on women, we know about trafficking, we know everything. There are very talented women filmmakers, you know, and I ask you, gentlemen, when you plan your next events, please take that in consideration. We're half of humanity.
Absolutely.
Ruth, it's obviously something we knew. We tried to work around. Things kind of happened at the last second. Wasn't intentional, but yeah, absolutely right. We are, you know, that's absolutely right.
Yeah, glad at least women could stand up and ask us a question like this. Otherwise, would not happen. Thank you.
We'll go with Bharadwaj.
So I come from making violent video games. And so my question, like, I know that there was an in-between talk about violent video games, and then Guruji at the end talked about video games. There is always this media talking about how violent video games are the reasons why violence are happening. Like, I spent my childhood playing Grand Theft Auto, and probably a lot of people would have done here. So, but we are not carjacking or anything. So what's your views on influence of video games in human mind? Thank you.
I just want to say Barth Vaj makes the first-person shooter games by day, and he's our Hindu pundit at USC by night. He's a Hollywood Hindu. So yes, what are the, what do you think about that? Is it that violent video games create violence in our society, or is it a release that actually has the opposite effect and decreases violence in our society?
Stories have had violence to them, the beginning stories. Every story that you know from any culture has got violence in it. Violence is also part of the nature of even the creative process. And, I think blaming the media is blaming. If we actually say who we are, because really, this whole evening, at least for me, is all about who we are. Each one of us individuals, each one of us group. It's not about them over there. And if we take consciously that, in fact, the actions that we all take do represent compassion and love to whoever we deal with. If you go make your video game that's violent, fine. I just don't, you know, if you're doing that with total commitment, just like Arjuna, total commitment, really doing the best you can to having integrity on the work that you're doing, and obviously in the evening, not apologizing, but expressing something else, I just think this idea of blaming the media is a diversion. I think we need to look at who we are, and then we'll create stories that have violence in them too, but we'll also create stories that have love and compassion in them as well. So it's too easy for me to blame the media and say, oh, it's the games.
Any other questions? We'll get, how about this the woman right here? Yep, yes, you.
Thanks. There's a lot of illumination on the stage and wisdom, and I thank you so much for that. It was really, it was terrific. I just wonder, why is it so hard for us to find our true nature? And there's a certain discipline involved in that. It sounds easy to say, use your imagination, tap into the infinite mind, but it's not that easy. And I want to know what we can do to help people tap into that discipline to do that, both in our work, in the media, but also in life. Mother of two children.
It's no effort. Take some time to be effortless, that's all. Letting go all effort, letting go all actions. Just be yourself, you know, like retiring. Like you sleep every night, but a conscious rest, not the sleep. Sleep you do take rest, but it's an unconscious rest. But if you can imagine a conscious rest where you do nothing but relax and let go, that's what is meditation is all about. That's the source of creativity. And whenever, wherever anyone has come up with any creativity, they would have found that moment, that deep moment of stillness in them, even fraction of second. So it's not you have to do a lot to make it discipline, but just let go everything. Like, you know, when in anger we say, I give up. But with a smile, I say, I give up for some time. You know, happily.
How about one more question, and the gentleman up front.
Hi. Actually, it's a blessing to be here today. One thing, I was looking at a video clip a few days back. It said that today's education was meant to serve the Industrial Revolution. It was basically designed to tell you how to earn more or do a mechanical job. And as you said, like, we are not trained to basically handle our emotions. I know there are some programs like Art of Living, or there is another one, Landmark Education, and I'm sure there are hundreds of more. But the thing is, how do you think, or what can we do to spread this education in masses? As in, what is the procedure to train everybody from basically serving the industries to serving the humanity?
Great question.
don't we all take a stab at that one?
I think this question has not a single answer. It's like the path. An answer can be, a correct answer, you can only take it once. But this is like a path on which you can tread many a times. So at different times, different answers can, we all should keep this, preserve this question in ourselves. And at different times, different answer will come and we should implement them all. There's not one thing, that many could be many, many things.
I think that if we remain true to being kind and giving to one another and we're patient, then we can find our true selves. You know, I'm very grateful for finding my passion as a filmmaker so early on in my life, but that doesn't necessarily happen for everyone. And when people ask me about that and they're still on their journey, I think, you know, as long as you're being kind and giving and patient, and you keep your ears open, I think that the universe does, you know, speak to us in very loud ways sometimes. But if you're not doing those first three things, you miss it when it's talking to you.
You know, that why is it so hard? It's because we believe in hard. We believe like having it hard is good for us. So I've enjoyed my hard. I've created great big melodramas about it. And at a certain point, I get, you know what, I'm tired of that. The boredom can actually be a transitional emotion from the you know, all those lower tier emotions of depression and anger and rage and hopelessness. And at a certain point, if we're really sincere about the journey and we are genuinely doing the work, one day it becomes a choice. And that's where it gets hard, because people don't want to take that level of responsibility. They want someone out there to tell them that it's okay. And I saw for decades how I was giving my power away to outside authorities and not giving myself permission at a certain point to say, you know what, I'm empowered here. I have the power of choice and I'm holding on because I want to. And that's the discovery for me. It is the liberation that, as some of my wonderful associates say, rather than, you know, the recoiling from responsibility, the beautiful, joyous lusciousness of I'm responsible for creating my own reality. When am I going to make the decision to change? And it's available at any moment.
Stop and be silent.
Well, I think that's a great way to end this evening. Please join me in thanking Jeremy Kagan, Norman Seif, Jason Pollock, and His Holiness Sri Sri Ravi Shankar.
We'd like to especially thank our hosts, USC, and Dean Brunsoni, who took time in the midst of a very difficult and challenging week to spend a lot of time putting this event together. So thanks to everyone at USC, and especially to Dean Soni, for hosting this event. And starting tomorrow night, the conversation continues and the silence deepens. Three nights of talks and actual meditations with Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, starting 7:30 tomorrow night at our center, which is just a stone's throw from here at the corner of Hoover and Adams. You can probably get tickets at www.artoflivingla.org. Thank you very much, everyone, for coming tonight.